Hello everyone, I just want to check if you can hear me. So as you see, I just sent a text. Okay, that's good. At least one of you can hear me. Good. Great, thank you. So let's see how many. We have so far 7 participants. I just wait a little bit and then start in 5 minutes. Okay, everyone, it seems that we just have 10 or 9 participants. But anyway, thanks for attending to today's online session. By the way, anytime if you have some problems in the video or audio, you just can text me either over GroupMe or over Zoom. So I can understand there is some technical problem. Anyway, before I send the lecture, let me show you 2 things since they also related to analytics and visualization. One of the tools that I just found, let me just minimize it. ArcGIS. So ArcGIS has a platform that you can easily learn and do visualization. Basically, just as an example here, You know, they are just showing the cases of coronavirus around the world. As you see, larger circle means there is more people struggling with coronavirus. So still China is the first place, then Italy, Iran, Spain, Germany, and US has almost 8,000 people. If I zoom in, it seems that most of the cases are in New England, which is, I think, the major is in New York. We have, like, as you see, about 2,500 confirmed cases in New York, in Massachusetts. It's pretty safe. We just have 200 people with coronavirus. So please be safe. I mean, quarantine, I think the most important way that you can be safe, and it just needs time to pass on. So please keep your morale. And I know it might be very difficult, especially at your age. I mean, just sitting in a place and nothing, just doing some routines might be very boring for you, but it's the only way that we can do, and hopefully we can just get rid of it in just a couple of months. Anyway, on top of that, I just wanted to let you guys know that ArcGIS.com has a good platform. It's as easy as Tableau. So you can just plot different information related to geographical locations, like coronavirus is one of the cases. Basically, the data for this map is are fed by Johns Hopkins University to the ArcGIS platform, and the rest is easy. The platform is already built. They just synchronized Johns Hopkins University data with the ArcGIS platform. So just keep in mind, is one of the things that maybe you can do in future. And even if your project related to geographical locations, you can just use ArcGIS, and later you can publish your work same as what Johns Hopkins University is doing. I already shared some links for you. So these are, the ArcGIS links. That one of them is for mobile version, another for desktop. And also, I found an interesting paper from Nature, which is almost the best journal around the world, because there is some like racism or political fight. People are blaming that COVID-19 was made by a specific country or institution to kill some other people. It's in this paper, which is, I think, is understandable for you. It sometimes might be a little challenging, but you can understand what is going on there. You can study the paper and see that COVID-19 is not laboratory-based virus. It just evolved in the nature, and it's the problem that we have. So there is no whatever plan or apocalypse thing that was made by specific government or nature. So let me just find the, just look at here. It's just saying that it's not laboratory construct or purposefully manipulated virus. Okay, anyway, I just want to let you know, guys, that there is so many papers going on with coronavirus. If you want to change your project to coronavirus, I'm very open for that. I think there's so many good resources that you can just Google and find data related to coronavirus, and you still have, I still accept that if you want to change your project something to related to coronavirus. Okay, let me send a text. I'm not sure if you're still hearing me. So could you still hear me? I just sent a text over Zoom. Okay, good. So anytime you have question, you can just okay, good, good. So anytime if you have any question, you know, you can have interaction over text me or just you start your video and ask your questions. So, any questions so far? No? Okay. That's great. So, let me show you the second thing. Today morning, I text you over GroupMe and talk about student challenge. Or whatever, MSBA poster contest. So I'm not sure if you already fill out the Qualtrics, but you know, last 2 weeks we had so many issues going on, and I was thinking that you might miss the competition, but we extended the submission time. And let's open the previous schedule, which is changed. I think it changed 2 times, so maybe I have a very old one. But okay, so March 23rd was the last day for signing up on Qualtrics. And as you see, I will send you the new schedule, but basically after March 23rd, me and a couple of other faculty supposed to read your abstract. And based on your novelty and what you mentioned in the abstract, you go to the second phase. And then you have to present your project, and we go over voting, and by it, we're supposed to announce the winners by April 24th. And basically after first round, some of you would be called to present their project. It's supposed to be through like personal presentation in one of the like Carson Hall classes, or maybe your same class in Jonas Clark building. But right now, because of the COVID-19 issues, it might be online. Today we agreed to make it online and extend some of the due dates. So, but I think we would send 5 or 6 of you to Informs conference, especially if you are in the job market in the next year, and you want to just interview with very good companies in your major, like in Informs, Google, Amazon, T-Mobile, Walmart, all of them who are hiring in data science come to the conference and they interview with people. So it's a really good opportunity, and hopefully you win. Otherwise, the next conference will be in Maryland, I think. You can take a bus for $20 from Worcester to there, and it really worth to attend to the conference. But keep in mind that the registration fee is pretty expensive, and if you win the contest, I mean, everything will be supported, including transportation, your hotel, registrations, and so on and so forth. I basically don't need to do anything extra. You're already doing your project. You need to have a good presentation. I mean, last time we had a like marketing challenge, and I attended the competition or challenge, whatever. So I've seen some of you did a really good job, but you have lack of good presentation. If you don't present well, people cannot understand what you did. So don't just show codes and think it's cool. It might be cool for you, but I mean, you're judge should see, understand what you do. And, you know, I'm just one of the judges. And maybe since it's your project, I understand what you did. But most likely, I don't judge my class or other faculties would judge you. And maybe they have business ethics course long term ago. So you need to have a good presentation for them, especially in the first round. Kemi Weston and Laura would judge you. And I'm not sure if they know anything about analytics. So what they appreciate probably novelty of your idea and how you interact with them. I mean, what they can understand from your project. So good explanation, good presentation is necessary, and please don't have typos. Typos would ruin your project. Having said that, you will see new schedule. Most likely you have one for instead of March 23rd, April 1st would be the last day for submitting your abstracts, which is, I mean, you should answer through the Qualtrics links that I sent you. Is either available through GroupMe or the one is in through one of your emails. So yes, please put a good amount of time, good presentation, and good project. And I will be more than happy to see you guys at Informs. Hopefully it will be, everything would be reimbursed. Otherwise, I strongly recommend to attend the Informs conference next year. Okay, so any question about contest, MSBA contest, or your project, your assignment? It seems no questions. Okay. Oh, one question. So let me see the chat room. Oh, so one of you said no question. Okay, cool. Let me just close the contest schedule. And just look over the 2 days lecture. Okay, today's lecture is about sentiment analysis and market basket analysis. So we have in last few weeks, we had some experience about what does sentiment analysis or text one in general means. We have seen that, you know, machine learning algorithms just understand numbers. You cannot let them just interpret anything. They cannot basically interpret anything except for numbers. They cannot understand what does a text mean. They cannot understand what is a picture, movie, or like sound means. So for sentiment analysis or text mining in general, we have one extra step that we need to convert our text to numerical values. And the rest is same. So each, basically after data preparation, we have some stem of the words and we use them as a variable. So basically one text could be divided to 200 variables. And then we use it for predicting a dependent variable. So sentiment analysis is a little different. Sentiment analysis based on lexicon that we have. We want to see if we interpret a positive or negative sentiment or meaning from a specific text or document. So just keep in mind, I extended the due date for the homework number 4 to March 28. It's supposed to be today, but I know that many of you are relocated, or maybe your mind was not that much free because, like, finding a new place, having a stress. So I rather to extend it like 10 more days. But it's not actually a difficult homework. You already have 9 workflow and you just need to do some changes. And if you look at your homework, I gave you some hints. So on top of the 9 workflow that we worked last class, you need to do some slight changes. And anyway, I provided some hints for you guys. Okay, I should change the next line, but you should have your laptop anyway. Oh, maybe some of you use cell phone or tablet for the Zoom classes, but anyway, just prepare Excel on them. So we use some functions of Excel, and also I need to say that you need to install Lingo software. So because from next week we go more to prescriptive analytics, something like linear programming. Basically, just as an example, let's say you have a system, you have a production line, or you have a factory, or you want to provide a service. How you minimize your cost or your input and maximize your output? This is the kind of problem that we want to look at them. So the way that we work with them is through a new subject. We call it linear programming, or you might remember as max mean kind of function that we need to use. So on top of Excel, this year I want to use Lingo. It's pretty easy. And basically, okay, let me just send you the text. I give you some instruction how to install it, but I'm just sending a text over Zoom right now. Lingo is not difficult, actually. Basically, the way that you write an equation on the paper, you write or type in Lingo and you can run some calculations. So basically, it's not a difficult software. Almost the learning Lingo could happen in 2 minutes, because you don't need to do coding something like Python, or you just write as it is. So shouldn't be difficult. Also, next week we have a quiz from chapter 2, 3, 4 of your textbook, and week 2 to week 6. Exactly next class and at 6 p.m. It's a lot, almost a quiet thing to study. And we have several type of questions. Most likely you would see 10 questions, but I have to make different type of questions. So, and randomly assign some question banks. For example, if 2 of you are in the library or your dorm, your questions might be different. So I don't say everybody has different questions, but you have different questions, and we have a limited time. So I sent you a link. You need to answer to the question, and basically, it would be like a SurveyMonkey link type thing. So you need to respond to the question in a certain time window, and after that, it will be closed. So be ready at 6 p.m., by 6 p.m. actually. We have at most 30 minutes of quiz, might be less, maybe just 50 minutes, but we started at 6 p.m. and hopefully you can get a good grade. Any question about your next homework assignment or the next quiz? Okay, let's see. Okay, what have you said? I don't say the gender, but he or she said I'm good. Oh, you can see his text. Oh, by the way, for the quiz, you need to open your video camera. It's just for being fair for everyone. So right now, I think almost all of you close your video, including me, because maybe it's not convenient for you when you're at home or other locations that you want to close your video. But for the next quiz, please be in the location that you can open your video camera. So during the quiz, it's like I'm looking at you guys. I don't judge you. You can have any outfits that you are comfortable, but you need to just open your camera for maybe up to 30 minutes. And after ending the quiz, you can just close your camera. So, yeah, you have some short answer questions too. Might be multiple choice, and also maybe like 30 lines of write-ups. And I can say the format is a little more, the type of question is a little more than quiz one, but there's some similarities. But basically, you have more questions to answer. I can say in comparison with quiz one, you see more type of questions and probably longer exam time. Okay, just as a practice, I just randomly pick a name. Let's say Chen Hao. Chen Hao, could you open your camera? Are you in the location that you can open your camera? Okay. So turn the camera a little down. Okay, something like this for the next class. So I can start my camera too. So if I want to take the exam, it will be something like this. Thank you very much. You can close your camera if you want. Cool. So I don't want to distract you guys. So I also, let me just stop my camera too. So by the way, if you have any question like Chen Hao, you can just even start your camera or start your video and use your microphone to ask your question. You don't have to just type it. Cool. So any questions? Okay, I have a question. How long will be the quiz last? At most 30 minutes. It should be less than 30 minutes. No worries, if you have questions, you can ask. We just have like 10 participants in today's Zoom, so. Any other questions? It's a little awkward. I can wait like a few seconds to see if any question could come in your mind. And anyway, no worries. Even if anytime you have question, you can just put in the text. So whenever I find a good time, I can get back to your questions and ask. Okay, last couple of weeks, we had some look at text analytics applications, lexicon-based sentiment analysis, and we used text mining for classification. And we had demonstration through NIME. Basically, you might remember that we look at the ratings and try to predict them. As I said, you can extend the 9 that I gave you, maybe for avoiding bias. You can show a 5-fold cross-validation problem and show that the accuracy or sensitivity or AUC of your folds are pretty similar. Is one of the ways, or if your data is not balanced, you can use sample balancing algorithm to avoid bias in your data and other things. By the way, I had an interesting question from one of your friends, and I want to show it today. And basically, you might remember that in the text mining, we get rid of punctuation, extra characters that we don't want, stop words, and then we do we lemmatize or do a stemming, and we reach to the stem of our words and use them as a variable for predicting independent variables. Your friend's question was mostly like how to make those independent variables manually. So you have a text. Instead of using packages or the NIME tools, how we can do it manually? So let me open NIME. And, okay, my version was, I want a little zoom in. Let's see, where is the zoom view? Okay, so let's see if I can make it bigger. Okay, with control and plus, we can make it with the use magnifier basically. So I posted the file, a very small file, and also this workflow, so you can see your friend's question. By the way, anytime you have questions, you can send me an email or over my office hours, which is now online, or your TA office hours. You can zoom in and ask your questions. And if you find it interesting, you can explain the class, like one of your friends' questions that I'm explaining right now. So look at the file reader. I'm reading a CSV file, which has IMDb reviews. Basically, it has a text and also some extra column related to a specific topic. So now let's say, okay, let me go back here there again. As you see in the genre, we have animation, adventure, romance, comedy, action, so on and so forth. So what we want to do, convert this text to some columns, and each column related to a specific genres. Let's say we have a column for animation, we have a column for adventure, action, comedy, so on and so forth. Okay, for this, first, we make a string manipulation node. In this node, look at the function index of genre, which is the name of column, and looking at animation. So what it does, let me go back here again. So it index of animation in genre. So what is the index? Index means basically location of a specific character, which is we are searching for animation in the genre column. Animation, the genres column. So if you look at here, if we have animation in that review, you get the exact location of animation in terms of how many characters from the left side, like here 21, 54. And if there is no animation in the cells, the value is minus 1. So,
Professor?
Yes, go ahead, please.
And this minus 1 value is a default one, or we are defining these values somewhere?
Actually, yes, it's kind of default values. Basically, negative 1 means there's nothing there.
Okay.
Basically, maybe you can interpret that as 0.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, good. Good question. So how can you work with that negative? Actually, you know, having minus 1 there, maybe it's not that much interpretable. And so you might have some questions, why it's minus 1? So basically, there's an internal functionality inside NIME, and what NIME is returning to me. So what I did, you know, also 21 doesn't make sense. I'm not really interested to the exact location of animation, how many characters from the left side of the cell. Also, that number is not meaningful for me too. What I'm looking for if the animation is presented in any movies genres or not. So I'm in the animation column, I'm looking at either 1 or 0. 1 means it has that genre, 0 means no. So I added the rule engine and said if animation value, animation is the name of column, more than negative 1, change it to 1. True to 0, I know it again might be a little challenging for you why it's the way, but you know, we should follow some internal, there's something on the background of NIME. So what it does, if animation has a location, which if in the genre column you have animation word, the location, you receive a location, could be 10, 27, 50, whatever. Means how many characters from left side of the cell. So if there is an animation, change the cell to 1, otherwise 0. So let's see what happens. So instead of 27, I have 1. Again, 1 means that genre, which is animation, is there. 0 means it's not there. So at the end, I converted like 21, negative 1, negative 54 to something 0, 1, which makes sense. And now I can use it for any machine learning algorithm that I can use later, like SVM, decision tree, neural networks, so on and so forth. And again, same for another genre. So I did action column. So if there is 1 means that movie has genre of action. Otherwise, 0 means there is no action genre here, over there. Some of you might ask why we're doing it. It's just a good practice. Maybe now you can use budget column too. So on top of animation, action, you can use other numerical values and add to them. Anyway, so the way that you see action, animation, and other genres, text money is doing something similar. It just changed a text column to some equivalent vectors or columns like animation, action, so on and so forth. But in the text mining, you might remember that we do a stemming. So instead of animation, maybe you just see anim, or instead of action, you just see act, because act is the root or stem of action. And the rest, I mean, you can do the rest of any machine learning project. Maybe you can do feature selection, resampling, and then use a machine learning algorithm for prediction. Any question about this interesting question? It was a question of one of your friends. I can wait a little bit, let's say 1 minute, see if you have questions. Otherwise, I go to the next topic. I know some of you are very nice and answering that you don't have any question. That's good. But, you know, maybe some of your friends are shy. So I wait a little, at least 1 minute. So, and then go to the next step because I don't want to just lose their question and they never ask. So, but anyway, I mean, even if you don't ask your question in the class, you can always email me or reach me and we could have online meetings. Okay, great. It seems there's no question for now. So today I just talk a little bit about other applications of sentiment or text mining in general, a little bit of methodology, and I already have an example for demonstrating. But most of the today's topic is about association rule mining, or R, and market basket analysis, or MBA. So MBA stands for Master of Business Administration, or could be Market Basket Analysis. And ARM also stands for Association Rule Mining. But, so generally speaking, in sentiment analysis, we just have a text. We want to see what is belief, view, opinion, or conviction, what we can get from a text. As you see, most of the data, I mean, even especially in the older times, there's so many textual data and we need to get something out of it. How? Either you do manually or you use text mining packages. You make, you reach to the sum of characters and use them as variables to predict a dependent variable. Or we want to see what's the people's opinion on a specific text. Either they have a positive or negative sentiment or feeling about any special topic. It has a variety of domains. And also I recommend to just do some literature review. CDC, Center of Disease Control, can easily find influenza outbreaks by looking at people's Twitter data. What they do, I mean, they read your tweets or social media, and if they see in some part of the country, people are talking about, I'm sneezing, I have headache, I mean, running nose, and other thing, other good texts, I mean, I don't mean influenza is good, but I'm just saying that you can have good text that showing that some people have influenza in some specific part of the country. Let's say, they look at the tweets or social media and see many people in Massachusetts are talking about bad feeling, sneezing, headache. So they can understand there's an outbreak of influenza in Massachusetts. Maybe they can talk with governmental officers and send supplies and inform hospitals that be prepared. It's a little different from coronavirus, because in coronavirus, they give you some fact sheet to test if you have the virus or not. But on top of that, they can also read the tweets. And tweets doesn't tell them how many exact confirmed cases of COVID-19 they have, but they can pretty have good idea which part of country is more has more cases. Other one, customer relationship management, or CRM. We had an example last week about the hotel reviews. So let's say you're doing some advice to Hilton Hotel Company, the company that's running Hilton Hotel, and you can tell them general people opinions about their hotels in any part of the country. Let's say you do a sentiment analysis and you can understand that in their hotels in Eastern Europe, people have very negative sentiments. Then you can focus on that location and understand what are the problems. Let's say you try to predict this review stars. I mean, the stars that they give to the hotel reviews. And then we can understand which word stems are associated to those stars. Just as an example, let's say clean is a stem of a word. I mean, and you can see when you try to predict the star reviews or rating of the hotel, clean, time, sheets, or this, just look at this example, are very important variables in predicting ratings of hotel in Eastern Europe. So you can tell Hilton manager that these are the thing that, and the reason that you're getting low rating in Eastern Europe. Your people are not happy about your time schedule. Maybe people are not really happy about the cleanness of the hotels and or the quality of sheet or having dirty sheets. So now, after you advise over the using sentiment analysis, the manager of Hilton Hotel can look at those hotels in the Eastern Europe and give them good feedback, saying that your schedule is bad. Maybe you don't prepare lunch or any food in the proper time. Maybe your sheets are dirty or they smell, and your rooms are not clean. So it brings two things. First of all, you can find which the locations that people are blaming the most, and you have the most negative sentiments. And then you can understand which factors are significant in predicting those ratings. And you can then report those factors and ask the Hilton Hotel to improve their sheet quality, timing schedule, and cleanness of their room. So it saves a lot of money for them too. So instead of reaching to too many hotels that they have around the world, maybe India, Asia, Western, Eastern Europe, United States, they focus on the location that has the most problem, and they save a lot of money, and also they can be more competitive in the market. All of them comes from text analysis. So what was the other way that they can check the quality of their product or doing CRM? Again, CRM stands for customer relationship management. Maybe they can hire somebody and talk with all of the customers, or hire somebody to do some text surveys. So it's doable in some aspects, but they need to pay many people to do that. And it's a direct way of getting customers' idea, but through sentiment analysis, they can get indirect feedback. It saves a lot of money. Instead of hiring people to do survey, they can indirectly get their customer idea and reach to them. More interestingly, in Twitter, I'm not sure it would happen for you or not. I had some banking issues with PNC Bank, and I was very angry, and I sent a text blamed PNC Bank. Unfortunately, I don't have the text right, the tweet right now, but in just less than 1 hour, the PNC found the problem and they reached to me and texted me over Twitter and asked me how they can help for resolving my issue. So, anytime if you are dealing with a very good company and you have some customer issues, maybe you are not happy with a specific service or product, you can even put a comment on Twitter, just post a text in it over Twitter. Most likely those companies would reach you. Basically, they have a different type of text mining, but basically they are doing such a thing. Any questions so far? Again, since it's our first, maybe second actually, first complete Zoom meeting. So the previous one, we most of you were in the class. So I'd rather to wait like 30 seconds, 1 minute, and then go to the next topic. Okay. So giving you some examples, you can understand other application of sentiment analysis or text mining in general. Voice of customers, like the PNC thing that I said, voice of the market. So want to react to your market. Again, one way is doing traditional way of doing surveys, reaching many people, but your sample size is limited, but over text mining, social media analysis, we can reach millions of people's idea and just do based on that. Voice of the employee. So a similar thing. Brand management, financial markets. Actually, I'm doing some research right now in the financial markets, but how it works, again, people look at the social media and also they use some algorithms to read news. So let's say I want to do some trades tomorrow. I'm not sure if tomorrow's stock market would go up or down. But I already train a model using social media or financial news. I understand which words are associated to up or down in the next day. So let's say I train that model for 2,000 days, or 2,000 is too much, maybe 1,000 days. And I could be able to have a good model for predicting tomorrow. Now I'm at my home, I run my algorithm, my algorithm reads news and social media. I can understand that what happens tomorrow based on people's idea. Just as a short example, maybe because of COVID-19, some of the companies in China or India would be closed soon, or in Europe. They announced their news. My algorithm read the news and can understand there's something wrong in some other part of the world, and tell me that tomorrow the stock market would go down. So I have this prior knowledge, and let's say in 8 a.m. I just sell all of my stocks, so I avoid a big lose. Or let's say my news is, we have some positive news about the good China's market, India's market, or Europe markets. Also in the Twitter, everybody is talking about they have money, they want to buy something, or they want to buy some stocks. My algorithm will tell me what tomorrow you have an uprise in the market. So buy as much as a stock today, because tomorrow you would make a good amount of money. And more interestingly, we have good papers about the relation of sentiment analysis and elections, which is under politics domain. I can tell you there is good amount of researchers that before any election, usually data scientists, they look at the social media, and then they can understand what people are going to do in the election. And like in the last presidential elections, all of the states were already predicted. Might sound crazy to you, but you know, by reading just people's interaction with the social media, many people could understand what happened in the elections. Or let's say for the next election, right now, I think Trump and President Trump and I even forgot the other names, but I think one of them is Senator Bernie Sanders and the other one, Vice President Joe Biden. These three gentlemen are like challenging each other. One of the things that they can do, they can understand that like for the, in some states, they don't have enough people or there is no good sentiments from social media of people. So what they can do, basically, they have two options. They can make a managerial call decisions. They either invest more in those states that it seems people don't have very good positive sentiments about them, or they can say there is no that much of chance in that state. Let's save our money and campaign better in a better way in other states. Anyway, this is actually a useful thing. I'm pretty sure those people are using these tools. Okay, this figure generally talking about sentiment analysis process. Basically, the first part is just getting your textual data gathering, basically, and doing some pre-processing. And next step is finding polarity of your documents. Is it more objective or subjective idea or type of analytics? Finding if you can get any sentiments, finding how much positive or negative are they, find the topics or target, and then just doing some insight about your analysis. Having said that, I mean, you know, maybe 7 years ago, 5 years ago, being able to code was really important thing in text mining. But more recently, many people are able to do text analytics. They mostly look what is your managerial decision or what you can get from your analysis. So in this class, on top of just understanding what methods are available for text mining or sentiment analysis, we mostly more need to do analytics part. We need to do more interpretation of the results. Okay, let's look at the steps again. First step is sentiment detection. Let me just read from it. Comes right after retrieval and preparation of text documents, also called detection of objectivity. So either is you are doing text mining over some factual matter or more subjective opinions. Sentiment analysis, I mean, many cases are mostly opinion-based analytics. Let's say we want to see if that text is more negative or positive. You can do for objective matter or factual thing too, like people do text mining for literature review. So they read some official documents and then and try to interpret, try to get the topic and understand what those documents are talking about. Next step, we need to calculate negative versus positive polarity. So we want to see if a specific document is mostly positive or negative. And probably we have a threshold that based on threshold, we can classify as a positive or negative. You saw we had some question last time because I play with the thresholds. Again, threshold could be either zero, anything more than zero, positive, otherwise negative, and you can just play with that. It doesn't need to, you don't have to have the threshold of zero, anything more than zero, you say positive or less negative. So after text mining, I mean, or you can do it before it, you need to find what is the text talking about. Is it about a person, product, or event? And it might be quite challenging. Let's say for Twitter analysis, I want to do I meant to do sentiment analysis for a specific candidate in a specific state. First of all, I need to have some hashtags to just filter the related tweets. Let's say in the previous, or let's just talk about the sport, Nike. So you want to understand what are people are talking about Nike. So you have you need to have find the related hashtags. One hashtag could be Nike, another one could be Just Do It or Michael Jordan. And then having good hashtags, you can pick the relevant tweets and then do sentiment analysis. Hopefully in the big data class, I give you some good example of text mining and understand how we can analyze the Twitter data. Okay, I already show you this vector extraction manually. It was the student question. I mean, one of your friends' question. And I post the code and text over code and data over Moodle. So if you go to week 8 and book 1 and 9 student questions, the one that was related to today's the workflows that I explained today. So when you go home, you can do, you can just extract those vectors manually, but you need probably extend and have more just repeat some nodes, especially rule engine and also a string manipulation for you need to do for each target. For lexicon based sentiment analysis, I mean same as other part other types of text mining, we have need to read data, do data preparation, and again, I repeat it again, in the preparation, you need to exclude some unwanted characters like question mark, punctuation, and so on and so forth. You need to prepare your data. Then you need to add a dictionary into your nine. So and the way that we did last week, we have a dictionary of positive character and negative character, and we just fuse them to the nine. Then we look at the frequency, I mean, pre-processing extractive words. We do term frequency. And you might remember we gave some weights to some characters through TF-IDF algorithm. Basically, maybe some words are more helpful for predicting the sentiment of some characters. And then we just, we have different ways of summing up positive or negative words or terms. And at the end, we judge about, for each document, do the text is positive sentiment or negative sentiment. As you see in this way, the, in the lexicon-based sentiment analysis, there's not that much of machine learning. Basically, just add two documents and count how many positive and negative words you have. So we don't have that. We don't train any algorithm. I don't use those algorithms for predicting new texts. Any questions so far? Let me just wait a little bit if you have questions so you can ask. Otherwise, we go to the next topic. Okay, next up is association rule mining. Then, by the way, let me see what time is it. I think I talked too much, so I give you 10 minutes as a break. I pause recording because next time that you, after I post the video, I don't want you guys to have 15 minutes of silence. So you can have a rest for about 10 minutes. Please get back to this session and we start talking about a new topic, which is association rule mining or ARM. So let me just pause the video. Let's see. Could you still hear me? Okay, I'm not sure how to pause it, but anyway, okay, so have a rest and talk about the remaining of topics in 10 minutes. Okay, guys, we start in 2 minutes. Okay, next topic is about association rule mining or R. Basically, it's mostly made over a statistics concept, but is a way old and common machine learning part of analysis. And we can say it's generally unsupervised learning because we don't have any dependent variable to predict or find which factors are associated to them. Basically, we have some, you can say we have some independent variables where we want to say how they come together. Let's say you want to go to buy something for your breakfast, and you go to an aisle, you find tea. Usually tea, coffee, coffee filters, sugar, honey, these kind of items comes together. So they are not in different location of a supermarket, or when we go to Walmart or Whole Foods, they mostly put them close to each other. Because based on association rule mining, which is sometimes it totally makes sense and very intuitive, if somebody buys tea, probably he or she is thinking of making breakfast, and maybe they need something to make it sweet. So they put some sugar or sweeteners there, or maybe tea filters, and so on and so forth. So, or if you want to buy, let's just say other examples, maybe you buy some soap, they put soap near shampoos, or like lotions, those kind of things. So they don't put in different part of this supermarket. It's very hard for you. For example, you just buy something for your bathroom. You don't want to just walk and just see all parts of the supermarket. You want to be very efficient and don't waste your time. Another example is the relationship between diapers and beers. So very interestingly, they put these two items close to each other. Can anybody guess why? Why beers and diapers are close to each other in the supermarket? No volunteers? Oh. Yeah, daddy bought diapers. Yes, Jay, right. So who buys beers? I think if there is a guy, most likely men buy alcohol. I don't say women don't, but usually the guy or girl who can buy beer, they are most likely more than 21, 25, and up to like 40, 50. This is the age that they usually make babies. And if you have, they have a baby, they don't have time, that much of time to go to bars. So if somebody has a baby and they want to drink alcohol, probably they drink at home. Might be the reason, but they're very interestingly. I've noticed many times they're close to each other. Okay, thank you from jail. So what is the input? The simple point of sale transaction data. So your receipts basically, but have you had any SQL Server courses or database courses so far? Okay, so probably you know what I'm talking about. Oh, so you just did by yourself. Okay, basically they have, record all of your transactions in a database. And through an example, we can see we make a CSV file out of that, which in each row, you have a transaction ID, and the next row, you have all the items in another cell. And we want to see which items go to with each other. Another example I put here, customer who bought the laptop computers and the virus protection software. Now, the input is two items, not just one. It's not beer and then buy diapers. Laptop and virus protection together. Also bought extended service plan 70% of time. So somebody, they make an association rule, which if somebody buy a laptop and virus protection, they most likely want to extend their service plan. So what can they get from it? Maybe they can put items next to each other and the one promote items as a package. So they based on their association rule manual arm, they understood that there's some interest for people to buy some items together. Maybe they can give them discounts so they can sell more and make it more interesting for people. Maybe some policies that just putting them apart each other, maybe for safety. Or another one is Amazon. So most likely you have seen whenever you buy something Amazon, they have some suggestion for you because they found some association rule between some items. And sometimes even they offer you two items on top of what you're going to buy and make it through a package. So our example so far, our example so far was about business, how to do cross-marketing, cross-selling, design of a store, catalogs, website design, optimization of online advertising, product pricing, and promotions. Also in medicine, healthcare could have a ton of application. For example, which illness may come together, which symptoms may come together. And based on association of symptoms, maybe they can understand, maybe 90% of time, or more than that, somebody who has sore throat, height and high temperature, and coughing, and lung pain, 95% of time they have coronavirus. You can look at in the predictive way too, but also there's a way that you can look at the symptoms and healthcare issues in a based on ARM algorithms. Any questions? Okay, let me just lay it for like 20 seconds and then I go to the next slide. Okay. These are just examples. We talk earlier in this topic, like married men have a kid, do not have time for a sport bar, and they up buying beer and just maybe they watch football at home. Or they put coffee near to beers. Maybe the reason. Sometimes we don't find a reason, but you find association with, you know, some reason or might be very intuitive and you can explain well, like daddies and diapers, and like maybe makes sense for you, somebody who consume coffee and also beer consumer for most likely. So what's the benefit for Walmart? So let's say beer drinker also drink coffee. So why Walmart take care of that? Maybe they can put in very separate locations and just let customers walk through aisles. What do you think, why Walmart put them together? Why they do ARM analytics and put items that have association with each other next to each other? So Taurus Lee said, create more margin. Would you like to explain more? So why Walmart put them together? You said more margin. So let them just walk through Walmart and just pick whatever they need. So Taurus, I think it's your nickname, but if you want to, if you don't want to talk it, that's fine too, but you can just use your microphone and video and just explain. Okay, Deep Shika's answer makes sense in some aspects. But creating more margin is right too. I don't say that's wrong. That's a true answer too. So let's say it's my interpretation. Maybe you can bring better interpretation. And as I said, sometimes it's very difficult to find a reason. But I can say, let's say I go to Walmart and I buy some beers. By the way, hopefully all of you are more. Yes, I think since all of you are graduate students, you are in the drinking age. So it's a good example. So you go to Walmart and it's like afternoon or evening and you buy a pack of Corona beers and you get home. Sometimes it's more like impulse buy, generating more sales. Yeah, I like Nopal's answer too. So let's say you go to Walmart in the evening or afternoon, you buy a pack of Corona beers and you go home or evening. And now it's like 7 a.m. next day and you need coffee and you don't have coffee. Probably if Walmart is far from you, don't drive back all the way to Walmart and buy coffee. Maybe you go to a Starbucks, or you have a convenience store next to you or in the gas station, and you go buy some coffee. So what happens to Walmart? Walmart didn't do any ARM analytics. They don't put beer and coffee next to each other. And you need both. And you didn't make income or revenue for Walmart, because next day you just remember, oh my God, I forgot to buy coffee, because you didn't see that. And instead of buying from Walmart, you buy from another company. So when they put items next to each other, you as a beer buyer, if you suddenly see coffee and you forgot to just put in a note that you need to buy both, you suddenly grab the coffee from Walmart and you make income for Walmart. Same for Amazon. Let me just give you a good example. Okay, let's say now we got rid of COVID-19 and you want to get back to a gym, and you go to Amazon and you want to buy a nice t-shirt for yourself. And Amazon put some, based on ARM, they also just suggest you to buy short or nice running shoes. So when you see them, maybe you want to buy and you make more income for Amazon or other ways. So anyway, you have seen that through association rule, you can make good amount of money for your organization. Let's give you some terms. You mostly have seen them in your statistics course, but now we just give them new name. So association rule, A implies B. Support rule, probability of A and B together. Confidence, probability of B given A. Leaf rule, or support divided by probability of A. Leaf rule is confidence divided by probability of B. And there's a rule of thumb. If leaf more than one, the rule is very significant. Otherwise, A doesn't have any impact on presence of B. Most likely people use one, but sometimes if you like 0.95, maybe they are okay. They consider as a significant rule. But basically lift, if you want to make it easier to understand, maybe we can consider lift as a like t-test or z-test in the regression. So you have some test that if you are more than some thresholds, you would say that association is significant, something like that you can see here. So leaf more than one. If leaf more than one, you can say A significantly implies B. We have some example later I'll show to you. And no worries. I mean, you can just by practice, you can just easily learn them. And the way that they show X implies Y, they put a bracket. So S stands for support, C stands for confidence. Sometimes instead of X or A, they say left hand side of LHS, Y right hand side of LHS. You can interpret it in a way like S or support, how often X and Y go together, confidence, how often Y go together with X. You don't need to memorize it, just see which way it is easier for you to understand and use it, that's fine. So in the previous example, Laptop computer and antivirus implies extended service plan. So support is 30%, confidence is 70%. As you see, X could be more than one. It doesn't need to be always one. Maybe it could be more than two, more than three. Any questions so far? Basically, again, at the end, we want to see if any association rule is significant. The way that we do, which calculates support and confidence and lift, based on the values that we get, we can talk about the significance of association. So there is an algorithm, a priori. Basically, you try to find a subset that are common to at least a minimum number of the items. Again, later on, we have some example you can easily understand. Basically, we find one-to-one association, two-to-one association, three-to-one association. We want to see which items goes to which items. And probably we put some minimum number of items. Maybe you don't want to calculate lift, support, and confidence for transactions just happen once or twice. Maybe you put a minimum cap for the number of transactions. So if some items are really to buy to go together, maybe even we don't do analysis. Let's look at this example. On the left side, we have some transaction numbers. And in the second column, we have SKUs or item numbers. So in transaction 1001234, four SKUs. SKUs is basically just, we can say, item code. So item 1234, what happened in the first transaction, in the second transaction. We had item 2, 3, 4, in the third one, just 2 and 3, and up to the end. Now, we want to calculate the support. Let me go back here. Probably A and B together. So here we just have one item. So basically one item support thing. How many transactions do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In three of them, we have one. So support of item one is 3 divided by 6. Second item, or item number two, with SQ number two, is in all transactions. So the support value is 6 divided by 6. And same for the 3 and 4. So let's do calculation for two items support. Item 1 and 2, we had already had six transactions. In transaction 1, 4, and 5, item 1 and 2 goes together. So the support value is 3 divided by 6. Same for item 1 and 3. In just first and fifth transaction, we have these two items together. So the support is 2 divided by 6, and we go to up to the end. And again, you can see we have support for three items. So 1, 2, 4 in three out of six interactions or transactions. So the support for that three item sets is 3 divided by 6. I give you like 20 seconds to just look at all the tables and see the calculations. So hopefully it makes a lot of sense for you. Any question on how we calculate the support? So, as you see, sometimes looking at the definition might be difficult, but when you have the examples, it is much easier. So support basically means how many times some items happen together, or what's the probability of some items happening together. I think it's very straightforward. Okay, so here we want to calculate confidence of 1 implies 2. So let me just grab a board. See if I can show it to another board for you. Okay, I should just wait a little bit. I should cancel the other one. I think I should cancel this sharing. Now I'm using my board to show to you guys. Okay, whiteboard. So it was, these are my transactions. So in first transaction, I had 1, 2, 3, 4. Second transaction had 2, 3, 4, 2, 3 in the third. Next one, 1, 2, 3. Sorry, 1, 2, 4. So let's just use my eyes. Next one, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the last one, 2 and 4. Now I want to calculate confidence of 2 and 4 implies 1. So it's the question. I just wait a little bit. So, by the way, can you see my whiteboard? I didn't get any answer. Could you see my whiteboard? Okay, that's good. Oh, let me just clean. So we know confidence is equal, if like A implies B, confidence is support divided by probability of A. And support means probability of A and B. Here, probability of A and B means item 1, 2, and 4 together. in how many transactions they happen together. No, together. Yes, three. Three out of six. So what is probability of A? In how many transactions two and four happen together? So basically here A means two and, yes, you're very right. Very good. So probability of A means five out of six transactions. So the confidence is support 3 divided by 6 divided by 5 divided by 6. These two sixes cancel each other and it will be equal 3 divided by 5. Very good. So if you have the slides open in front of you, could you calculate confidence of, so this is for now, calculate confidence of two and four implies three. I give you like 2 minutes, see if you can calculate. Okay, so one of your friends said 3 divided by 5. I haven't calculated it. And another answer, I got it. 33 divided by 4? Really? 3 divided by 4. So let's calculate the confidence. So first of all, support. Support means how many times 2, 4, and 3 happen together. Here, here, and here. So support is 3 divided by 5, right? And we also need to find probability of 3. How many times 3 happened? 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes, 4, in the numerator, I made a mistake, 3 divided by 6, sorry. So in the denominator is 4 divided by 6. So the answer is 3 divided by 4. Very good. So I wait like 1 minute, see if you have any questions so I can explain. Otherwise, I go to the next slide. Or maybe we can calculate lift too. Let's calculate lift. So lift was confidence divided by probability of B. By the way, in the previous calculation, I made a mistake, right? Confidence was support divided by A, right? So support means probability of all of them together, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 3 out of 6. Probability of A means the left side. How many times 2 and 4 happen? Here, 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 and here. So 5 divided by 6. Answer is 3 divided by 5. Sorry, sometimes happens. Okay, now you calculate lift. So we want to see, we want to check if this association rule is significant or not. So let me change the color. No. So we want to see 2 and 4 implies 3 is a significant or not. So a couple of you answered. I'm not sure if you see your friend's text, but also please say if it's significant or not. So 9 divided by 10, is it significant or not? Yeah. Yeah, as I said, we can have it depends. Usually threshold is 1. And usually, based on rule of thumb, more than 1 means significant and less than that is not significant. So, but let's do the calculation. Hopefully, this time I don't make any mistake. So, what was the confidence? Confidence was 3 divided by 5. Now probability of B. Probability of B means right side, right? Or finding probability of 3. So how many times 3 repeated? Here, 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 yes, 4 times. So it's equal 3 divided by 5 divided by 2 divided by 3, 9 divided by 10. So again, you can. Actually, if you say significant or not significant, both is right, but you should say what is your threshold and what's your thinking process. If you say, since it's less than 1, I don't consider it as significant, it's fine. And you can say, also, you can answer it in the other way, saying 9 divided by 10 is very close to 1. So I still think there is some association, significant association. That's fine too. So, the way that we evaluate you is based on your thinking process and what was in your mind. So again, here both answers could be right. Any questions? So just I give you 1 minute to think and. And if you can have any questions, you can just simply ask. Yes, one of your friends says one is a typical standard. This is like a typical threshold. Okay, one had a question. Just let me read the question. Actually, Mark, you look at basket analysis is very complex content. on top of confidence, leave, intervals, we have other factors too. But for the class exams or assignment, you can just, if you consider leave is enough, more than enough. But also you can talk about confidence interval. Actually, confidence interval, no, confidence. Confidence interval is a, another statistical term. And it's different from confidence here. So yeah, please don't confuse between confidence interval and confidence. Now, confidence interval is like, let's say you want to estimate a regression, the slope of a regression line, and you say the slope is 0.8. So how you're comfortable is 0.8. It could be 0.5 to point like 1.1. So that's a different topic. Yes, Xiaolin was right. There are different concepts. I can wait more if you have other questions about this concept. I really appreciate Deepshika. Deepshika always asks questions, and I truly appreciate it. Good job. Because if she doesn't ask a question, maybe next time it will be your question and you never ask the question. So it's a really good habit to ask your questions. So let's look at the next slide. Here we also are trying to find lift of A implies zero. As you see, instead of A and B, X and Y, you can say antecedent and consequent. So this is another two terms. Oh, you don't see my slide, so sorry. Let's see me just. Okay, let me change from. This one to this. Hopefully you see my slide right now. Okay, so instead of saying A implies B or X implies Y, you can say antecedent implies consequent. And in this example, we try to calculate antecedent of lift for antecedent of A that implies consequent of Z. Please don't afraid, you know, we have so many terms here and don't be confused. At the end, you just need to calculate support, confidence and lift. So what it might have, based on the author, they might use different terms like A and B. Someone might use X, Y. Someone might use antecedent, consequent. So anyway, so here, this is another example that we try to find the lift for A implies zero. So first we calculate support. And it's another way of doing that, but basically a short way of doing that. But anyway, at the end, both of them are same thing. You can use the formula that I posted here. What is that? Okay, I got the formula. So you need to find support, confidence, and lift. Then the thing that I more look at that, how you interpret the result. So based on this lift, do you think the association rule between A and zero is significant or is not significant? So the lift is 1.31. Yeah, it's more than one. Yeah, it's more than one. So there's a significant relationship between A and zero. So let's say A is like coffee and or beer, and zero just is the item code of beer, so or coffee. So if they find a significant association between them, they try to put them together to make more money. So at the end, the financial interest is the reason that people use association rule analysis. Okay, now we have a hands-on experience, and I show you how to use nine for association rule mining or market basket analysis. I give you like 5 minutes to download the market basket analysis workflow from your Moodle, and probably it asks you to install some extensions. So I just give you 5 minutes to download this work, to log into your model and download this workflow, and I go from that. Okay, hopefully you downloaded the workflow. Actually, the workflow is very extensive for your assignment or your project. If you need, you don't have to do everything that I did here. Basically, let me show you the PowerPoint. That's the only thing that you need to do. You need to have read the document, split. You need to call a cell split note to split your receipts to the items. And let me go over there somewhere to show you. Like here, you know, in each cell, you have several items, you need to split them. So you need to let Naeem knows that this cell has several items. So anyway, input, split, then there's a node that can find association rule. Basically, you don't have to, it seems very easy, but in this Naeem, I have a very extensive kind of workflow. Hopefully it's not very confusing for you. But again, at the end, for your assignment or exam or whatever project, you just need to use these three items. First, read, split, and association rule. That's it. That's more than enough. But let me just go one by one. Complex node or meta node, if you enter it, you see that I entered two tables. The first one, table reader, let me just open it. As you see, it has row ID and the items inside the cell. I need to let Naeem know that cells is not a simple string. It basically has several items that need to be split. So I enter the table in the cell splitter. I'm just saying here, I just let Naeem know that need to be split the cell for me. That's it. Let me open the table for you. Now, in one column, I have the original data, items in my order. In the second item, you see almost same thing. You know, look at the name now, call zero, underline split, result set. So what it happens here, the left column is what you imported in your Naeem. The right one is the format that Naeem is happy to read. So for Naeem, if you want to run association rule, you cannot run over column zero. You need to convert to a format that makes sense for Naeem. The right side, which is column zero underline split result set, is not maybe human friendly, but is Naeem friendly. So there's no mathematics behind in here. We just convert to a human-like format to Naeem-like format. So it's the format that Naeem is happy with that. Look at the second tab, a specific column specification. As you see, column zero is just a string. Column zero underline split result set is a set variable. So it's not a string, it's a set. Again, set is much easier for Naeem to work with. In the second table, let me just open it. I just imported the price of the items and the name of the item. Because in the previous table, you just see what items are in each transaction. With the second table, you can interpret them. How much is the unit price of each item? What is the name of those items? So code zero means Swiss cheese, or one means cherry coke. number two string. So if I show you the format, it said item is a number, price is a number, and product name is a price. We know that item is a code, it's not a number, it's not a numerical. It has some numbers there, but those numbers are not, you cannot sum them all up or subtract them from each other. These numbers are also a string. So in this node, I just convert the numerical value to a character. So let me close this meta node. So what I'm doing here, basically I imported two tables. One of them has transaction and what items are in my transaction. And the second one just interpret the name, what those names, number means. But the most important note is association rule. In association rule, what I'm saying that use the column zero underline split result set. The minimum set size should be one. Minimum support number, not probability, 10. And if there is such a requirement satisfied, just run association rule learner for me. You see something extra here, double configuration. You can even exclude it. It doesn't hurt you. I just want to tell you that here I just said default size 5. So I just imported, I just made a new parameter, which is minimum support. And I said it's equal 5. In the next one, if you go to flow variable, I just said min support is equal min support that comes from double configuration node. So min sub instead of 10, coming from here, coming from the previous node, node 114, which is equal 5. Again, the double configuration node, it just do a little change in the settings of next color, and you can even exclude it. So this node could be just excluded and it doesn't hurt you that much. So all the thing is happening in the association rule node. And if I open the table, you can see the result. So you can see the antecedent. As you see now, the name changed from consequent to antecedent. Let me open the this file. So antecedents means the left side, consequent right side. Basically, antecedent implies consequent. So what does it mean? Item 177 and 225 implies item 102. We have the support frequency is 17. And if you check the percentage, it's 0.593. Confidence percentage is 11. And you know, there's other measures that I don't go in them except for rule. And the rule is 3 point something. So that association is significant. So since the rule is more than one, item 177 and item 225 significantly implies item 102. I hope I didn't make too much of confusion for you. So I'll just wait a little bit if you have some questions. hopefully it makes sense for you. So we had some transactions and we just imported them, and we had a split rule learner. And from that node, we understood which items are antecedent and consequence. We just let Naeem to do it for you. We didn't do manually. And you know, if you wanted to do manually, first, we have so many items, first of all. We need to find support for one item, two item, three item, then the confidence for one employees one, two employees one, three employees one, then finally calculating leaf. Manual is almost impossible for so many items. For a small number of items, it's very easy to do. But for such a huge transaction, we need to use the software, which is Naeem. I just waited a little bit, so if you have questions, you can ask, and then I go to the next part of the workflow. And that's enough, but you know, I did some extra thing here. For example, look at here, I imported some names. Oh, sorry, let me just open. And price. Maybe the extra thing that I did here is just assigning names to these items. Like what does 177 and 225 means? What does 102 means? So in the next part of this workflow, I'm just change these numbers to names and maybe do some calculation. So items times price give you the revenue or how much you sell. And these things happen in ungrouped collections. This is a meta node. In the first one, I made a row ID column. So as you see, now instead of having row ID as just separate identity, I made a new column and just copied those names here. In the second one, based on the antecedent, we just ungroup them. So some items might have 1, 2, 3, or 4. So we just ungroup them. So now if I open it, you see some rows are repeated because for item 102, we had two antecedents, 177 and 227. So it's the reason it's just repeated twice. And the joiner one, so we had antecedent number. Let me just again open it for you. So first they were in the set, then we split over independent items. So once 177, 225 has one antecedent of 177 and 225. Now we join based on the item names. Let me go back. I know it might be a little confusing for you now. Look at here, I have item code. These are the antecedent code too. So based on this code, I can just join price and product name from this table. Oops. to this table. So let's see what happens after joining. Now I have price column and product name column. So hopefully, I think many of you have had SQL database courses before. So you can, joining the items could be easier for you. So let's say we have antecedent 177. It means licorice. 227 means gummy bears. Oh, sorry. 177 means liquor ice. 225 means gummy bear. 46, Kobe beef. It's very expensive beef. So anyone have you ever tried Kobe beef? None of you? Oh, well, I have an answer. Actually, a Kobe beef is very expensive. I want, also I like to try it. And the most expensive one is Wagyu. So it's very expensive. And maybe I like to try once in my life. Anyway, so as you see, we had antecedent as a set. We split based on the unique codes. And then we joined to the first table to find the unit price and also the name of those antecedents. Any questions so far? Okay, it seems no questions so far. So let's go what I did again. Then, you know, what I did basically first, I had a question. Let's see. Yes, actually we merged more than two columns. One of your friends asked, can we join more than two columns? You know, in the joiner, look at here, you join based on common values in one single column of each table. In one table here, before joining, I had antecedent and consequence and some association rule measures like confidence, lift. Then we use antecedent sharp one to join to the our basic table that we imported based on the item column. So each time that you join, you should join based on the common values of columns, one column from each table. In group by, now I want to just, I split it based on antecedent column. Now I want to merge them. And as you see here, now I don't have repeated row numbers. All of them are unique. And names before group by was in different cells. If the row ID are same, I mean, these two, we put liquor ice and gummy bears together. So it happens in here, liquor and gummy bears. So first we split, then merge with the information that we had about the codes, and then again we merge them. Then changing some column names, and I just let you to do it later. Then also, we want to find the name of consequent. So, because in the earlier one here, the join was for antecedent. We find what is the name of antecedents. Yes.
Can you just go back to the joiner one and open the property box?
This one?
Yes. So That was my question, was that we can see only two areas to join, top input, that is a left table and a right table. Does that mean we cannot include more tables to the joiner, or we can?
Good question. As you see, you can add more columns for each table. But you know, it's not the goal. You can do that, but what's the goal here?
Whatever is common between them, right?
Yes. We want to see basically what was the name of those items. Okay. So if I add more by plusing plus sign here, I'm putting more constraint. Because I want to say also join consequent, maybe some of them maybe doesn't make sense.
Okay, I got the point. Yeah.
The goal of here is finding the name of antecedent. So we just merge based on antecedent code.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. In the second joiner, we want to find what was the name of consequent. So we join based on consequent ID from the first table. And item column from the second table. So what happens? After joiner, we can find the name of consequent product. So now, if you want to read from here, you can say liquor ice and gummy bears implies blue herb. Or vanilla cake implies watermelon. I'm not sure. Some of them may be hard to interpret, but you can use this data for basically for designing your superstore. Some of it is funny, like vanilla kale implies hamburger. Anyway. In the math formula, I want to find the price. So just price times quantity, you can find basically the revenue, how much they sell. And the last one, also I changed some column names. So let's look at the last table that I have. And I go to column specification. As you see, there is a single number. One of them is set, antecedent items. So what happens here, I cannot export it to a CSV file for other usage. Because if you want to export from NIME, the column should be either number or string. It's a limitation of NIME. So for this reason, I added the column rename node. As you see, I just said antecedent item, change it to a string value. From now, if I open the table and go to specification, I don't have any set variable because antecedent items change to a string. And last one, CSV writer. If I go to setting, I just said, I find the location of the result that I want to save. And I just say write column header, row ID, and if there's existed, overwrite it. I okay and run it. So if I go to my documents, now I can find, this is the basically export of my analysis. So I can find which I can see the association rules. I can use it for designing my supermarket, finding which one is a significant one and which items go together. Some of them actually may be hard to interpret, some of them might be much easier. For example, I'm not sure why ravioli goes with vanilla cake, but or vanilla cake goes with Chinese food. So, but it's based on what people buy. So, anyway, so again, for finding association rules, the only thing that you need to do is import, split the receipts to the items, and or basically here in the cell splitter, we just need to change the format and then running association rule. That's it. Again, here I did more complex because I want, instead of just code, I wanted to find the name of those codes and also write a CSV file of my results. So it's the reason I have some extra node, but basically just with two or three nodes, you can easily run association rule, find which items goes to each other, which items and which one are in, you have significant association. Any questions? I might talk too much, so I just wait 1 minute, see if you have any questions. Okay, no question. You already have a seminar quiz, so I don't post a new assignment. But again, if you have a new assignment, you just need to probably do some changes. Maybe same as the previous assignment, that the due date is the next week. Maybe you need to add some. Maybe you need to do some search for finding some notes. Again, search is here. Like, for example, if you want, let's say last in your assignment, I said use two machine learning algorithms. Like, for example, So you search for SVM and you can find the node and just drag and drop. Or sometimes you need to imputation, you need to search what does, what is the node. Sometimes you need to Google it because they are not already installed. Maybe you need to go to file and install extensions. Install name extensions. Sometimes you need to install extensions because some nodes are not installed by default. Anyway, I mean, this is the way that you do for your assignment. So assignment by assignment is a little difficult. For example, for previous one, I give you exact hint how you do that. Maybe next one, you need to do some search by yourself. But again, next week we have a quiz. Chapter 2, 3, 4, week 2 to 6, probably 10 questions and almost many formats that you can imagine. Please log in to the Zoom by 6 p.m. so you don't miss the quiz. And I think probably it's worth two quizzes because it's too much, I think. It makes more sense to get like, just consider as a two quizzes credit. Any question about next week assignment or quiz, or have you started assignment and you had the question? Again, thank you very much. I know Zoom class, online class is very difficult. Hopefully it doesn't affect your learning too much. And we try to work around it, finding a way that you learn enough and with a good quality, and also make it more fun. Sorry, today I think it was too much, but We try to work around that. Maybe if you have some suggestions to change some parts, just let me know. We just keep working online sessions, mostly up to the end of semester, because to have you safe, please be safe. Don't go to the like restaurants or like gatherings. I mean, just wait like a couple of weeks. Hopefully everything will be, every problem will be gone. And I see you soon, healthy, happy, and without any issues. Thank you very much. After the session, I posted over my YouTube channel and send you the link. So if there is no questions, thank you. Have a great evening.